This video is made possible by the free-to-play action game Crossout. Check out the game through the link in the description below, and you can start with 3 extra weapons or a vehicle cabin just for registering. So in today's video, we're answering a viewer question, because James H. asks us, how realistic is the idea presented in video games of shooting a plastic explosive to set it off? Given that their main and really own purpose is violently exploding, you might be surprised to learn that most explosives utilized by the military are shockingly stable. In fact, C4 won't even explode if you set it on fire and then you shoot it. Indeed, beyond the benefit of being able to shape the explosive in a variety of ways to accomplish a given destructive goal, one of the main reasons plastic explosives like C4 are utilized so extensively by the military is precisely because they are largely inert and can be handled without specialized equipment. Further, creating C4 is noted as being a relatively simple process that involves mixing a plasticizer with a conventional explosive. In this case, usually cyclotrimethylene trinitramine, often referred to as RDX or Royal Demolition Explosive, or for the non-Brits, Research Department Explosive. While exact ratios vary somewhat, for reference, in its C4, the US military currently uses a mixture of 91% RDX, 5.3% of the plasticizer dioctyl sebacate, 2.1% of synthetic rubber, and 1.6% mineral oil, or for civilian use, motor oil, giving such C4 its telltale odor of, well, motor oil. Commonly likened to ordinary modeling clay in texture and consistency, C4 and most other plastic explosives can be shaped, stored, and molded just as easily. The key difference is that, unlike modeling clay, a mere half kilogram of C4 can turn a typical vehicle into a pile of scrap metal. The key to making this happen, though, is attaching some form of blasting cap. As the name suggests, these blasting caps rely on a smaller and controlled explosion, which will in turn cause the explosive components within the C4 to go off, resulting in the C4 producing a wave of gases, including nitrogen and carbon oxides, that rapidly expand outwards at upwards of 18,000 miles per hour. So fast is this effect that it actually creates something of a temporary vacuum around the core blast area. This results in a second, much less violent wave of air collapsing in on the vacuum after the initial blast. Not keen to just rely on theory, the US Army has conducted countless sensitivity tests on C4 and other plastic explosive compounds, shooting them with bullets of varying calibers and even putting them within feet of things like hand grenades to see if that explosion or subsequent shrapnel could set the C4 off. The Army has even conducted tests to see if things like fire will cause C4 to explode, all with very little effect. In fact, it turns out C4 not only remains stable while on fire, but it actually burns quite slowly, making it a good fire starter if you don't mind the poisonous fumes. While you might think that soldiers would be scared to use the compound in this way, both because of an accidental explosion possibly happening or from the noxious gases that are given off, amazingly, during the Vietnam War, using several small chunks of C4 as tinder to light campfires or even as the sole source of the fire itself was indeed a thing that many soldiers did, despite military brass advising against it owing to the poisonous gases that were given off. Further, beyond its use as an explosive fire starter and badass modeling clay, it turns out that when eaten in extremely small amounts, C4 is known to produce a mild high likened to being drunk, something soldiers in Vietnam also took advantage of. It's probably worth mentioning at this point that when consumed in anything other than extremely tiny quantities, C4 can cause a host of health problems, as noted in a case study published in the Journal of the Royal Society of Medicine in 2002, where a soldier decided to swallow about a cubic centimeter of the substance. Doing this can lead to things like generalized seizures, lethargy, coma, muscular twitching, hyperreflexia, myalgias, headaches, vomiting, mild renal injury, and hematuria. That's blood in your pee. Alright, so let's get back to the extreme stability of C4. As they often do, the show Mythbusters took the idea of testing this to its logical extreme. They shot a piece of C4 that was currently on fire with a high explosive incendiary round. The C4 stubbornly refused to explode even then, despite the incendiary round giving a nice little blast on impact. There is one caveat to all of this, however. It turns out there is a way to set off C4 by shooting at it. How? While there are a variety of designs for blasting caps, some may be set off by being hit with a bullet, thus providing the needed energy to cause the C4 itself to explode. Why this is an extremely unlikely scenario in the real world is because these blasting caps are typically very small. Think about half of a used pencil, and anyone trying to shoot at them would presumably want to be a fair distance away, just in case they were successful. This all becomes even less likely in real world scenarios, given that you don't put the blasting cap in your C4 until you're preparing to make it go boom. So in the end, while there are certainly many unstable explosives that will happily release their destructive power if you were to shoot them, it turns out plastic explosives and pretty much the majority of explosives used by militaries and for industrial use the world over are almost always shockingly stable, precisely because these organizations aren't keen on deploying explosive devices that might go off unexpectedly. So the reality is that video games are not really like the real world, but hey, that's why they're fun. And if you're looking for a video game that will provide you with hours of fun, then you should absolutely download Crossout. And I want to tell you a little bit about Crossout before we get into the bonus fact today. Crossout is an online vehicle action game where all of the vehicles are made by the players. Basically, what you do is you construct your own crazy vehicle from the ground up with all sorts of different parts. You can add weapons, support systems, a main structure, and a whole bunch else, from railguns to rocket boosters. It's a super fast-paced game, and there's loads of different game modes. You've pretty much got also limitless freedom to create whatever you want. How your vehicle looks and behaves is entirely up to you. And it's also not a really complicated game to start with. There's a very easy learning curve, allowing you to make your own vehicle very quickly and get into the game super fast. So you can join us on the battlefield for free using the link in the description below. This game works on PC, Xbox One, PS4, so they've really got you covered. And going through that link below not only helps support this show, but you also get a free starter set with 3 extra weapons or a vehicle cabin, and that's all just as a bonus for registering. Again, thanks to Crossout for the sponsorship, and let's get into that bonus fact. So speaking of shooting at explosive devices, during World War I, there are documented instances of soldiers using shotguns to destroy thrown hand grenades before they could reach their target. For example, in Leroy Thompson's U.S. Combat Shotguns book, he notes the following accounts where a group of soldiers acted in concert in this way. Their first warnings were German potato masher hand grenades lobbing through the air. Few landed, as most of them were exploded in the air by the experts in the outposts. Upon the failure of the grenade attack, the enemy launched a mortar attack. Again, the trap shooters proved their worth, deflecting the slowly arching bombs. Finally, a vast gray wave of the Kaiser's best surged forward. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please give us a thumbs up below. Also, don't forget to subscribe. We've got brand new videos just like this every day of the week. And check out our fantastic sponsor, Crossout, link below. And as always, I'll see you next time.